for the children that participated so nicely in the story and my actors that did this, and the song services, the Sabbath school. Sabbath is such a special day. Come and look. Just to walk in the doors and it's special. It's great to be here. To be with God's children, my family. Today, I have chosen a talk called Jesus First. A few weeks ago, I took a Vesper service and I entitled that talk, It's All About Jesus. And today is Jesus First. It's important that we remember that. Scripture is full of it. Difty read out the scriptures, Luke 4, verse 20. And the eyes of all of them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And then again in Matthew 6, verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. In the fourth chapter of Luke, when our Lord went to the synagogue, in his own town, the Bible has a very striking statement when it says in verse 20, and the eyes of all of them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. They weren't too sure what he was going to say. Remember, it was his hometown, and they weren't too sure about this strange man with a strange message. But nonetheless, they couldn't help themselves. Their eyes were fixed upon him, and they heard his message. And the story of the Transfiguration, when they went up into the mountain, and when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. What a tremendous text. They looked up and saw no man save Jesus only. We need to see more of Jesus. We need to see more in our lives, in our actions, in our thoughts. In Acts, we have a wonderful story about the Ethiopian woman. He was riding along, minding his business. He was reading, actually, the Bible, trying to understand it. And all of a sudden, Philip appears. And Philip was the one who led him to Christ. The Bible says, then Philip began at the same scripture and preached Jesus unto him. What same scripture? The wonderful text that says, the eyes of all of them that were in the synagogue were fastened upon him. That is the way it ought to be. It's the way it's always been. It's the same scripture, and preach unto him Jesus. That's what Philip did. The eyes upon Jesus. That's the way to go. That's the way it ought to be. And the Grecians, some Grecians came once and they said to the people, sirs, we would see Jesus. And you can find that in John chapter 12, verse 21. In Rome, Rome is a city that was increased with goods and great, big city in Italy. But what they needed was Jesus. Whether in Galatia, north of Jerusalem, or Rome, in Europe, need is always Jesus. Our message is a message of Jesus for all people. You know, sometimes we fixate on the Sabbath or tithe giving or something else. If we would remember to fix our eyes on Jesus, put him first, the rest will follow very easily. Think about the church in Sincrea over in Greece. It was just about 60 miles or so from Athens. And their need was for the Lord Jesus Christ. The church in Ephesus, in Asia, the church in Colossae, they were worshipping angels. And the church in Philippi, happy and joyous people, but they needed to see Jesus. In Thessalonica, in Greece, they all need Jesus. Titus on the island of Crete and John on the island of Patmos, scattered all over the globe, but they all have one need. Every single person on this earth has one great need, Jesus. And when we seek him, he needs to be first in our lives. The book of Hebrews was written to the Jews who were scattered all over in the then known world, and all needing Jesus. You check out the Bible. It's amazing. No matter who the people were, it doesn't matter where the nation was, nor the circumstances, the need was for Jesus. I tell you, my family, my church, the need that we have is for Jesus. The church was built on the person of Jesus. And say what you like, but there is an attractiveness in the preaching of Jesus that draws men to him. What the world needs is a simple picture of Jesus through you and through me, through the man who came back and helped the blind girl put her fruit back. No wonder she said, "Are you Jesus?" Nobody had been kind to her before. Nobody had cared. She sat there day after day trying to sell her fruit. One man came back and helped her. And through that, the girl thought she saw Jesus. It's my prayer that whenever we meet somebody, in this church, on the street, in our place of work, they might be thinking in their hearts, "Are they Jesus? Do they know him? Is that who they are?" Put Jesus first. Make him first. Once somebody said, "Jesus, the Bible was Jesus on paper." Well, that's nice. And that's very good. But I want to see Jesus in people. Each one of us, as we go about day by day, not on paper, we read it on paper and assimilate it into our hearts and our lives, and we become like Jesus. And I would believe that this church, every single one of us, will be so like Jesus that people will want what we have. Look at Jonah. He went running away. Bernard said in the scripture that Jesus said, "I will be always with you, behind you." That's our problem. We we are running away. We need to turn around and come back. When Jonah ran away, his name, he ran to Joppa. The word Joppa means board. And boards in the tabernacle were covered in gold, much gold. We need to give more gold to Jesus in money, in time, in love, in worship. Mark it well, this church will grow, but only in direct proportion to the way it magnifies the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Read the Bible. It is a love story. The most wonderful love story ever told. Do you know what hippies and alcoholics need? What modern so-called cultured atheists need? What about the fallen man or woman? What do they need? And what about dope addicts? And all of us as well. We may come to church every Sabbath and sit here righteously. We need Jesus as much as all the others that I've just mentioned. Whether you're in an old country, a new country, a big country, a smart country, or a dumb country, wherever you come from, the need of everybody, whether in Thessalonica, or Rome, or Galatia, or Jerusalem, or Philippi, or the Isle of Man, wherever you are, those people, these people, need Jesus. Now, more than ever before, we know when we hear the news, when we see what's happening around the world, I've just been 3 months in Africa, and I can tell you that the world is in a mess, and I can only believe that Jesus will come soon. And so we need to shine for Jesus all the more. And I'm just going to tell you what in the book of Acts, in the New Testament, how often Jesus is put first. In Acts, Jesus is shown as the power of the church, and rightly so. But Luke starts off talking about Jesus. He puts Jesus first. Paul shows that Jesus in the gospel of Christ, he is the gospel. And he says so in Corinthians. He shows Jesus as the restorer of the carnal. But he starts off talking about Jesus. In Galatians, he shows Christ as the ripped veil. But he starts off talking about him simply as Jesus Christ. And in Philippians, he talks about Christ being our sufficiency. And so he is. But he jumps right into the subject at the start of Jesus. Jesus Christ. In Colossians, he talks about Christ being the shadow. But he starts off within the simple acknowledgement of Jesus. Timothy, he talks about Christ as being a glorious and appearing Christ. And so he will be. But he starts off first. He talks about a simple exaltation of Christ, our hope and our Savior. In Philippians, he is the one who forgives the straying servant. In Hebrews, he's listed witnessed for Christ is better than all the angels and the prophets and the priests and the kings. But God has spoken to us through his Son Jesus. In James, Christ is the restorer, the fulfiller of the law. But he starts by saying, James, the servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. You notice that they all start off, they show you an aspect and a facet of the character of Jesus. But they start off with the man Jesus first. In Peter, he lays the foundation that Jesus is the revelation, the rock of our salvation. But starts off by saying, Peter, an apostle of Jesus. In John, Jesus is the assurance of our salvation. In Revelation, John shows him as our coming King. But he starts off by saying, the revelation of Jesus. We need to be a revelation of Jesus. Jesus needs to be first in our lives. So what am I saying? I'm saying that whether the mayor, the city council, or the King of England, or anyone else for that matter, does or does not do, we ought exalt Jesus Christ, no matter what anybody else is doing around us. Jesus first in everything that we do. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. As you have seen in all these New Testament, Jesus is first. Surely there are enough examples for you to choose one and to make it your solemn duty to follow one of them, Jesus, first and last. When people see you, which Jesus will they see? I pray that we will display all those beautiful characteristics at different times in our lives. Make up your minds to shine and shine for Jesus, no matter what. I think God wants the first fruits of your income. The tithe is the Lord's. God wants to be first in everything. Your time, your money, your talents, everything that you are and ever will be belongs to God. And if that is true, and it is true, make him first in your life. To end off, I just want to tell you a little story. It shook me up a bit when I read it first. It's about a missionary who went to a foreign land where they worshipped pagan gods. When he came back home, he told this story to his congregation. He said, I saw a lady on the banks of the river, worshipping the Nile River. People believed that they could appease their gods by offering their children to the crocodiles in the river. I want to just pause here and say the difference between other religions and ours. Other religions have to do something to appease and to make their gods happy. They have to pay money and give food and sacrifice. But Jesus, he did the opposite. He was the one who sacrificed. He and God and the Holy Spirit, they sacrificed for us. I can't grasp it. I don't know about you, but to me, it's such an amazing concept that the power of the universe will come to save me. However, the lady, he saw this lady on the banks coming to worship the Nile. And crocodiles always come up when people come to the banks. When people see them there, the crocodiles come because they know they're going to be fed. He saw the lady go down with two babies. One was bonny and chubby, smiling and gurgling, and the other was very pale and sickly, coughing very weakly. She laid the babies down beside her, one on each side. Then she picked up the healthy, rosy baby and threw it. The missionary ran down to her. Wait a minute. What are you doing? Why are you doing that? The sickly baby couldn't live much longer. Why not give him to the crocodiles? And the heathen lady said, Sir, I don't know. What God you serve. I don't know about your God, sir, but my God deserves my very best that I have to give him. And with that, she picked up her sick child and walked back into the forest. It brought a lump to my throat. God deserves your very best. He deserves your life. The first day of the week, first fruits of your income, the first place in your life. Will you determine to give him the very best of everything you